Good afternoon, dear students. Today we are going to talk about meninges and cisterns of the brain. The meninges are protective membranous coverings of the brain and spinal cord. The meninges consist of three membranes from outside to inside. It is the dura mater, the arachnoid mater, and the pia mater. It is worth mentioning over here that the dura mater is mesodermal in origin, while the arachnoid and the pia mater are ectodermal in origin. Over here is the picture, enlarged version. Over here you can see this is the brain substance. Closely investing the brain substance is the pia mater. Above that is the arachnoid mater. And over here you can see the dura mater, which is having two layers, the outer endosteal and the inner meningeal, the details of which we will be talking. So, giving you an overview of these meninges, the dura mater. Mater actually means mother, dura means tough. So, dura mater actually means tough mother. And it forms the folds, the dural folds, which we have heard of already. That is the fox cerebri, fox cerebelli, tentorium cerebelli, and diaphragm ocelli. Now, since the dura mater is very tough, fibrous, and inelastic, it is known as pachymeninx. Pachy means thick. And inner to the dura mater is the arachnoid mater, which is having a cobweb-like structure and it is avascular in nature. Whereas the pia mater is thin, transparent and vascular, and pia means delicate and mater means mother, as I have already told you. And arachnoid and pia mater together are termed as leptomeninges. Lepto means thin. Now let us discuss in detail about each of these layers. First is the dura mater. It is very thick, dense and inelastic membrane and the outermost layer of the meninges. It is having two layers, the outer layer which is known as endosteal layer and the meningeal layer is the inner layer. These are closely united except along certain lines where they separate to form the dural venous sinuses. The endosteal layer is basically the periosteum, okay, which is attached with the inner surface of the skull bones, and the endosteal layer very, very specifically ends at the level of foramen magnum, which means that it is not continuous with the dura mater of the spinal cord. And the meningeal layer forms the covering of the brain. It is continuous beyond the foramen magnum into the spinal cord. And as I have already mentioned, that the meningeal layer will be folded to form four septa or dural folds between the parts of the brain. And the function of these septa is to restrict the rotatory displacement of the brain. This is another diagram, a picture, which shows you the endosteal layer, which is attached with the cranium. This is the endosteal layer of the dura mater. This is the dural venous sinus, and this is the meningeal layer of the dura mater. This is the arachnoid. Arachnoid sends like a very thin fibrous cobweb-like meshwork down to the pia mater. And over here, this is the pia mater and this is the cerebral cortex. This is another picture which shows the location of the four folds which are formed by the dura mater. This is the fox cerebri and the tentorium cerebelli, the fox cerebelli and the diaphragm ocelli. Over here in this diagram, I want you people to concentrate on this gap that is present, this U-shaped gap. This is the tentorial notch over here, okay? And this is the tentorium cerebelli. Now, talking about this diagram over here, we have got the brain substance over here. This green color thing that you are seeing over here, this is the pia mater, okay? And over here, this is the arachnoid mater. Arachnoid mater is sending these arachnoid villi. These are projections from its surface, which are protruding and invaginating into the dural venous sinus. And of course, the dural venous sinus, when we see, this is the endosteal layer of the dura mater, and this is the meningeal layer of the dura mater. Now, let us talk about the various folds. First, let us see the fox cerebri. It is a sickle-shaped fold of dura mater that lies in the midline between the two cerebral hemispheres. Its narrow end in the front is attached to the internal frontal crest and the crista gallae. The broad posterior part, it blends in the midline with the upper surface of the tentorium cerebelli. The superior sagittal sinus runs in its upper fixed margin, which I will show you in this diagram over here. This is the superior sagittal sinus right over here. Okay, and the inferior sagittal sinus runs in its lower free concave margin, which is located over here, right over here. Okay, and the straight sinus runs along the attachment to the tentorium cerebelli. So, right over here, this you are seeing the tentorium, at the point of junction between the fox cerebri and tentorium, you are seeing that the straight sinus lies over here. This is the labeling. Again, please pay attention. This is the superior sagittal sinus. This is the inferior sagittal sinus. This is the tentorium cerebelli. And this is the straight sinus. Okay. Now, the tentorium cerebelli is a crescent-shaped fold of dura mater that roofs over the posterior cranial fossa. It covers the upper surface of the cerebellum and it supports the occipital lobes of the cerebral hemispheres. So, over here you are seeing the attachment of the tentorium cerebelli. Okay, this is the tentorium cerebelli. The fox cerebelli is a small sickle-shaped fold of dura mater that is attached to the internal occipital crest and projects forwards between the two hemispheres of the cerebellum. The posterior fixed margin contains the occipital sinus. So, in this picture, it is located over here. Now, the diaphragma cellae, it is a very small circular fold of dura mater that forms the roof for the cella tersica. A small opening in its center allows for the passage of the stalk of the pituitary gland. We call it as infundibulum. So, this is the location of the diaphragma cellae. Let us talk about the nerve supply of dura mater. The supratentorial part is supplied by branches of the trigeminal, and so pain from this region will be referred to the forehead, whereas the infratentorial part is supplied by the vagus and first three cervical nerves, and pain is referred to the occiput. The dura is basically sensitive to stretching, which produces the sensation of headache. As far as the blood supply of the dura is concerned, the dura gains its blood supply from the internal carotid, maxillary, ascending pharyngeal, occipital and vertebral arteries. From the clinical standpoint, the most important is the middle meningeal artery, which we have seen in the skull you know, that it enters the skull from the foramen spinosum, and all of you already know that, okay, which is the most commonly damaged in head injuries. And the venous drainage goes into the meningeal veins, which lie in the endosteal layer of the dura. The middle meningeal vein follows the branches of the middle meningeal artery and drain into the pterygoid venous plexus or the sphenoparietal sinus. Now, this arachnoid matter, it is a very delicate, transparent, impermeable and avascular membrane which covers the brain. And it lies between the pia mater internally and the dura mater externally, as we have already seen in the previous diagrams also. So, separated from the dura by a potential space which is known as subdural space. It is filled by a film of fluid. And it is separated from the pia mater by the subarachnoid space, which is filled with the CSF. The outer and inner surfaces of this arachnoid matter are covered with flattened mesothelial cells. In this picture, you can very well see that they have lifted up the dura mater, and underneath that, over here, you can see the transparent layer which is known as arachnoid matter, and underneath this arachnoid matter you are able to see the superior cerebral veins, okay, and other veins over here. So right now, please see in this diagram that projections from the arachnoid matter, they are projecting. Evaginations are there into the dural venous sinuses. These are known as the arachnoid villi, and as the age of the person advances, these villi clump together to form larger arachnoid granulations. These are known as Pacchionian bodies, okay, and from the undersurface of the arachnoid towards the pia mater, it will have very thin, okay, cobweb-like, you know, meshwork. These threads will be present over here, okay, over here, which is going to give this space, which is known as the subarachnoid space, a sponge-like consistency. Because in the subarachnoid space, we have got the CSF, and we have got these very thin fibrous meshwork, these threads which run from the undersurface of the arachnoid onto the pia mater, which give this subarachnoid space a sponge-like consistency. Okay, over here it is worth mentioning that the superior cerebral veins, which are present beneath the arachnoid, they traverse the subdural space to reach the superior sagittal sinus and its lacunae.